Hey, friends, welcome to the podcast. Let's kick it off with our favorite sponsor, Blue Crown Aquatics. So we have gotten shrimp from these guys. We really do recommend them. We got a nice variety. Jim, you've been raising them. How's it been going?
It's going great. I love these little guys. They are growing quickly. They're voracious eaters, and I wish I had more.
So these guys just don't only sell shrimp. They sell a lot of other, you know, neocardial shrimp accessories. Certainly check them out, BlueCrownAquatics.com. And with our offer code, Aquarium Guys, you get free shipping.
Free shipping? Nobody does that.
It's not just free shipping like I pay for Amazon Prime. No. When you do fish, fish cost a lot of money, and shrimp cost just as much.
Does he know he's giving free shipping?
We
didn't make this up, did we?
We didn't make it up, but I'm pretty sure he didn't really realize what we set up. So take advantage of it before he pulls it away. Again, promo code Aquarium Guys at BlueCrownAquatics.com. And just to sweeten the pie, we have a drawing, a giveaway for $25 gift cards. We have four $25 gift cards to give away. So go to theaquariumguyspodcast.com. At the bottom of the website, you'll see a giveaway link. Click it, sign up, and we're going to get that drawing done at the end of the month. And our goal is to get Robbie Chan himself on the podcast for a shrimp spectacular and make him do the drawing, because who better?
It's like Red Lobster, endless shrimp, right?
Endless shrimp.
Endless shrimp.
Endless shrimp. Man, we should work for his marketing department.
We should. And after he probably meets us face-to-face, he'll probably just punch us. I don't know.
Hey, we got to ride the wave, right?
Ride the wave.
BlueCrownAquatics.com. And don't forget about our favorite charity, Ohio Fish Rescue.
Call those nut jobs up. We love those guys so much.
So this week, I just got a message from Big Rich. And apparently, they are working with their local DNR services to evacuate a massive man-made pond.
Really?
And transfer all of these species into a native lake before get this pond cleared out. So they're spending a lot of time, a lot of effort. These guys go insanely above and beyond for fish that aren't even part of the hobby that just need help. I mean, it's amazing when the DNR can reach out. But again, Ohio Fish Rescue. .com. Give them some love, buy a t-shirt, donate some money, and give them a call.
Give them a call late at night. No, don't call them late at night.
But tell them you love them.
Tell them that Rob and Jim said, what did we tell them?
Well, better yet, I want to change this up.
Yes.
Tell them you love them, but above all else, tell Big Rich you love that amazing mullet.
Oh, man, that would make Billy Ray Cyrus so mad.
216-773-0407. All right, guys, let's kick that podcast.
Welcome to the Aquarium Guys Podcast with your hosts, Jim Colby and Rob Zolson.
Oh, what? Hold on, I think we're getting some interference. One second. I think we have a problem here, ladies and gentlemen. Jim, what the hell is that thing in your mouth?
I got my birthday gift from my wife.
Okay, who gets a didgeridoo for a birthday gift?
Me, man. I got a didgeridoo.
You know, I've seen, you know, let's take you out to dinner, let's go to the movies, you know, let's...
Lame.
But a didgeridoo. I thought it was a sex toy when you brought it in.
It is pretty large.
And in charge.
And in charge, yes. We went to a rock concert not too long ago. We saw a band called Like a Storm that opened up for Ozzy Osbourne. And then we were lucky enough to have them come to our local facility nearby in Fargo, North Dakota. And we went to their show, and they play a didgeridoo during their hard rockin' act. I mean, they are a hard rock band. And we got invited on the tour bus with them and talked to them for about 45 minutes, I think, we were on the bus. And anyway, we were able to order a didgeridoo direct from them. So they made it for us, and they sent it to us in the mail. And so I have a Like a Storm didgeridoo, and I'm rocking the house.
So, if I'm doing the math correctly, does that mean that when you go to Madonna's farewell concert, you're going to buy a bra?
Some cones.
Just some cones.
Just some big cones, yeah.
All right. Well, I am your host, Rob Zolson, and the other gentleman sitting across from me is...
Hey, it's Jim Colby here, having a good time.
Just... Digin' the Dew.
Digin' the Dew.
Digin' the Dew. Adam is also with us. Adam,
hi,
help
guys.
Me.
You're stuck with him. I'm four, like 5-6 hours away.
See, this is the pain of being in the actual studio here, but we do what we can. So hopefully, maybe we can get you practiced on that.
I'm gonna learn to play. I don't know if you probably didn't catch it, but I don't know how to play it.
I thought it was a dying moose call.
It could have been, you know, if there's could be some moose out in the backyard going looking for love in all the wrong places. But that's a whole nother country music story.
All right. One more tangent. We're in Minnesota Vikings territory, right? And I don't know if you ever heard or listened to a Vikings game, but you'll hear in the background when they score a touchdown, there's this giant Nord horn, and I thought that's what he was going to do tonight.
Mine's too small.
It is.
That's always been the case. Mine's too small, and it's not big enough. But, you know, this didgeridoo, I'm thinking, you know, I'm going to learn something, and maybe I'll do some solos later on, you know, if we have some requests.
Message us, guys. AquariumGuysPodcast.com.
We're gonna have a 20-minute didgeridoo solo. I already can tell.
Oh my god! All right, you have to play the kazoo or some shit, Adam. That's
okay.
And we'll get one of those monkeys.
The triangle.
And I'll just fart in the mic.
You know, and let's get one of those monkeys with the cymbals. You know, that just bangs the cymbals. Let's get one of those monkeys too. We don't have to pay them.
This podcast is degrading now.
Yeah.
All right. AquariumGuysPodcast.com. At the bottom of the website, we have our email address and telephone number. You can call and leave us a message so we can play it on air and request that Jimmy never play the didgeridoo again. It's up to you. But
I'm right here. I can hear you, and I have feelings.
All right. We hearing check is complete. We can mark that on off the list.
One done.
So we
got Facebook too.
What?
So we have Facebook. You're beating me to the punch here.
What's Facebook?
I'm sorry.
I know. We're not social people, so getting to social media circles is getting bigger. I mean, next, Jimmy's going to have a Facebook. He already has a Twitter.
I'm not ever going to have Facebook.
Everything in time.
No.
Hey, if your fans demand it, I have to wear a crop top. You have to get on Facebook. That's the halfsies we got to go with.
I've heard about Facebook, and that usually gets a lot of people fired, from what I understand.
Well, don't post those type of posts. These are just fish fans, man.
Oh, okay.
Keep the didgeridoo out of your derriere.
All right.
And we'll be good.
Jeepers, it's getting tough in here.
It is. Real tough. So, again, we have a new Facebook page, guys. We have a Facebook group that we want to share, post, comment with. Facebook doesn't allow you to, you know, really swap creatures anymore or sell any type of creatures, but we're going to do everything else under the sun that we can possibly do on that Facebook group. So, the Aquarium Guys community is what we have on Facebook. Certainly join up. We even have Jimmy's wife is one of the admins, so we're gonna make sure that it keeps clean.
What?
I know.
Does she know about this?
She does, and yeah. She even accepted a few people today. We just opened it like this afternoon, and we already have over 100 people.
100 people doing what?
We're gonna find out together, Jimmy.
On Facebook.
On Facebook. Togetherness.
So you're telling me that this new thing called Facebook, which I've never been a part of. It's not new.
Kids are already off of it.
What?
Mr. Pickles has been railing on me all week we're old people for being on Facebook.
I thought it was a place you could swap recipes or something.
No, but apparently there's fish people on it, and a lot of them.
Oh, man, they're crazy people.
Right. So, again, Facebook, we already have Twitter. Jimmy's been having fun doing that. Find us on Discord. That, by far, is the best way if you want individual help from us. Go on Discord. I'm on there all week. Adam's been joining on there. So hop on Discord. The link is, again, aquariumguys.com. It's on the bottom of the page. You're welcome to join. There's no paid for. A lot of people have Patreons that you have to pay to get in. It's completely free. Join us. It's really fun. And, we have question time, Jimmy. We have a big list of questions.
From
statements, reviews, people that pretend to love us.
Oh, your mom.
Well, people that pretend to love you, they actually love me.
Oh, your mom.
Well, I mean, it's not mom. I can verify with names, man.
Really? Yeah. Who'd you make up today?
And it's not Betty White either.
Well, ooh. If Betty White called, it would be.
All right, you guys. Enough with the celebrities thing.
Fantastic.
Let's take a minute. We're getting a ton of listens. It's just every week. It keeps more and more in building this podcast. So, Tracy Morgan, if you're listening, we want you as our celebrity guest on the podcast.
Oh.
I called it out. I said it.
You called Tracy Morgan out.
Tracy Morgan.
Yeah, I'm sure. Maybe he'll pull up in his Porsche and join us here.
Everything in time.
That would be cool.
I don't even know if he has a Porsche.
You know what?
I think he makes that type of money.
Maybe he could swing by and pick up Betty White, and we could do a double date type thing.
That everything in time. Everything in time. All right, so questions. Before we go to the questions, this podcast is going to be our personal favorite podcast. It might go a little longer this week, and it's going to be tips, tricks, and hacks.
Brought to you by the letter T for tips.
So the one good thing that, you know, us haggly old aquarium guys can offer is better ways to do things for cheaper, because we're penny pinchers. And Jimmy had a quote this week that said, we're going to make you 100 heirs. Is that correct?
100 heirs.
100
yes.
heirs.
100 heirs.
Are Not we... millionaires. We're going to make you 100 heirs.
Yeah. We start small and we'll work our way up to millionaire. But no, we have to be make everybody 100 heir by saving you some money. And by the end of this podcast, everybody will have a $100 bill magically in your pocket.
Poof.
And if you don't, just give Rob a call and say, where's my 100 bucks?
Hey, you know, small tax at the bottom pocket. 100 air does not include qualify. You know, insert here.
That's right.
So questions. Question time. Let's start with, and again, we've been having this giveaway.
Giveaway.
I added a add comments box. So when people are signing up for this giveaway, which you're getting a lot of people signing up, they're actually putting questions in the sign-up sheet as well. So it's two birds with one stone.
So they say you suck.
Right. So get on the giveaway, guys. But been listening to the podcast since day one. Love the length of the podcast. Love hearing about different topics. Would love to hear something about biotypes. Dirted, Wallstead. There's different types of biomes in an aquarium type, and they want to hear more about it. And I think that'd be a great addition for a podcast. It is now on our lists. So learn through the podcast, not through direct means. Keep up the good work. I appreciate that. Next one is learn through your podcast through the Aquarium Co-op. While he did not name you directly, he did mention of a new aquarium podcast coming up. Binge watch your episodes for 2 days. Absolutely love your content. Keep it up. So I searched this, and yeah, we were certainly mentioned indirectly, but we'd love to have Corey on the show. And we did reach out, but we reached out pretty early. We reached out when we were only a couple episodes in.
Too soon.
You know, anybody that has a tutorial content that's supposed to be teaching beginner people about fish needs to be concerned about the type of content they're going to bring new aquarists attention to. And it's fair, you know, give us time to vet it, get more episodes in the on our podcast, and prove ourselves before he introduces his young aquarists to be potentially misled. So
yeah,
makes sense. And I'm glad you picked up, and thank again for the compliment. There's one more bit at the bottom of this. Also feel it would be fun to have a discussion about shrimp.
Shrimp.
Right.
We might have a guy that we can talk to about
shrimp.
We have
a guy.
We have a guy now.
So our plan, again, we talked about at the beginning of the podcast, is having Robbie Chan. He is the CEO of Blue Crown Aquatics. And again, they won awards 2018. And who better to have on and talk about shrimp than the expert himself?
And aren't they building a new facility also?
They are. They are. We weren't supposed to talk about secretness now.
Secret
Come
time.
On. Secret time?
Secret time.
He's apparently starting up some details in Chicago. So we'll see what entitles. It's just make sure you get your shrimp at a sooner time so you can not only send from the California region, but also in the middle of the country.
We'll see if we can get him to confess to some secrets.
Secret time.
Secret time.
Secret time. All right. So I also have a question that was sent by email.
Was it from the federal penitentiary?
It was not this time.
This time.
This time. So,
because I love hearing from your mom.
The question is, do I need to put leaves in your tank for them also?
For
assuming
shrimp.
They mean by shrimp. Oh, there is. I got to look at the title of the email. The title of the email has a separate question. So number one, can you tell me about high protein pellets your guest feed his Placo? So the pellets he was using is Massivore. Massivore pellets are generally used for monster fish. They're almost pure protein. They advertise that they have 2 or 2.5 goldfish per serving. I forget exactly how it is.
How many pellets are a serving? Yeah.
Exactly. I don't know how it's done. You can check on their marketing material. But Massivore is very much utilized in the industry for high protein and monster fish. So we'll have a link for that. We're going to go over tips and tricks, and we'll try to get that link to you. But check out Massivore. You can get it on Amazon pretty much anywhere. And do I need leaves in the tank also? I always recommend leaves, and we're going to talk more about leaves in this episode. So,
yes, we love having the leaves. Almond leaves. You have a tip, a trick on that too, don't you? A little cheaper one.
Let's start right in. So
jump in.
You know, Jim, Adam, and I all have sat this for the last month and have been creating documents of our tips, tricks, and hacks of just for this Pinnacle podcast, our favorite podcast. So what we'll do is we'll go around and, you know, we all drew straws and, you know, Adam got second place, Jim got last. So sorry, Jim. It had nothing to do with your didgeridoo. You just have to wait on this one.
I'm just going
to
play didgeridoo during the whole time Adam's talking.
Didgeridon't. Please. Didgeridon't.
Wow.
Right.
That hurt. Didgeridon't.
All right. So I'll go first on the list. So number one on the tips and tricks. Everybody uses different tubes for siphoning in their aquarium. And the process is, you know, one of the tube goes in the tank. Generally, it has some sort of cone, so you can use a gravel vac. And the other end, you have to sit there and suck on the tube to get it started. I've had mouthfuls of crap many times before in my mouth. Not fun. So simply purchase a hand pump siphon. They look, I don't know if you've ever, we're in Minnesota, where a lot of us are boat drivers. It literally looks like a little squeeze ball that you put between the line. You give it a couple squeezes, and it's already primed and emptying. No mouth to tube action at all.
It's kind of like one of those old-fashioned blood pressure cuffs.
Exactly. That's what it is. Except instead of, you know, talking why you should eat more Cheerios, it's just putting water into a bucket.
Really?
Hey, we're not sponsored by Cheerios.
If we were...
I'm just worried about your cholesterol, Jimmy.
Hey, shush up. What else you got there, big guy?
All right, next, for cleaning, especially in smaller tanks, is the magical turkey baster.
What?
So, if you have a 10-gallon or less, it is a pain in the rear end to get there with a whole under, you know, gravel siphon. It makes small ones, but why do that?
So this is for like a quick cleanup?
A quick cleanup. And turkey basters are nice. They're really precise. Squeeze the cup, point in, and they just suck up the waste, crap, or remaining food. And it's a spot check. It's really handy. You don't have to use a net to try to scoop up stuff, you know, disturb the water. You just simply suck up whatever you want. And they make turkey basters in any length. Any turkey baster will work. Go in your mom's, you know, kitchen drawer right now.
Right.
Clean one off.
Yes.
Thoroughly. You don't want gravy grease back on that thing. And it's really handy.
And use it.
But don't put it back.
Yes. Put it back. And then during Thanksgiving Day dinner, just sit there and chuckle while everybody's watching you eat.
Okay. Secret time.
Secret time.
Secret time. I just stole my mother's turkey baster when I was younger. And sure enough, I used it to try to, you know, get some eggs that were bound. No one taught me. I was a pretty newbie at this time. And I sucked up eggs, and sure enough, they died. You're supposed to leave those particular eggs alone. I think they're Corydora eggs or in a little mound.
Okay.
I tried to suck them up to put them in a basket. They all died. But regardless, I just decided to, you know, rinse it off and put it back in the drawer. And sure enough, there's a big gob of eggs on the side.
Ooh.
My mother did not use it until 2 months later. And guess what? It was Turkey Day.
Thanksgiving.
I don't do gravy. Mm-mm, I didn't touch any of that. That was used. Yeah. No. And I kept that to myself, and they said how delicious it was that year.
And I hope your mother's not listening to this.
I think she started. That's what makes me nervous.
Really?
Yeah.
You can come to our house for Thanksgiving this
All
year.
These mom jokes from you douchebags.
Wow.
Yeah.
We love you, Mom.
Love you, Mom. All right.
Greetings to the penitentiary. Is that where she's at?
Greetings. Next on the list.
All right.
So for those of you that have acrylic tanks, they can scratch easy.
What are you, the Rockefellers, if you have an acrylic tank?
Well, no. Some people just get them, you know, used or whatever else. Or maybe they have money, unlike us.
Yeah, acrylic tanks are expensive, but real pretty. Pretty easy to scratch.
Pretty easy to scratch. So people are nervous when they're trying to scrape algae off their tanks. They, you know, try to be gentle or, you know, chemically treat their tank. Don't. Instead, here's a ghetto tip. Go through your collection of gift cards, you know, the ones that you used up online purchasing your crap already.
Taco John's.
Take an old gift card or an old credit card and just use that as the scraper. It's a plastic surface. It still has a sharp-ish edge, and it's very safe to go against your acrylic.
Wow.
Right. Just what we call the hobo algae scraper.
The Hobie.
Hobo. The only problem with this is you have to have someone to love you to give you a gift in the first place.
I was going to say, or else just use your mom's credit card.
All right.
Secret, buy your turkey baster.
Secret time. You can also steal them from Walmart because they have those gift card displays. Don't recommend it. Stealing is illegal. But you can totally do it because they're just gift cards.
Wow.
Right? Or, okay, let's do a legal method.
And you wonder why your mom's in the Walmart penitentiary?
You can go into Walmart and ask them for an old, used, thrown away credit card, and they'll probably pull one out of their basket. Gift card, yeah.
Okay.
All right. Next one, quilt batting.
You making a blanket?
I we're in Studio B, as Jamika so precisely calls it, and there's a lot of, it's wall-to-wall yarn in this room. It works great for a podcast studio because it's already sound insulated, but there's a lot of crafting items, including two sewing machines right to my left.
Your wife has a problem.
Right, but what I do is I steal polyester quilt batting from her, and she doesn't even know it until wow. she listens to this podcast, and I'm going to get beat upside the head.
Your mom and your wife don't listen to this podcast. You're just lying.
I hope not.
Yes.
Cross your fingers. So polyester quilt batting is the best filter material to use, and it has to be 100% polyester, or it can be toxic to your tank. So you can buy rolls of this quilt batting online for pennies. It's real cheap. And you have a roll that you can cut to size to fit and use as filter medium. If you have some sort of sump, if you have a hang on the back filter that you want to stuff some with, any type, or just a cover that you can put around a pump head if you want. So quilt batting is the best replacement for any type of filter media. Then on top of it is the ghetto media, biologic media. So normally you see people getting these, you know, media beads and all these craziness.
They're expensive.
They're very expensive. And if you want to use any sizable amount, it's astronomically expensive. So instead, go to your local dollar store and you'll find these bales of like 8 to 10 plastic pot scrubbies. It's been used by aquarists for a long time. Use these plastic pot scrubbies in replacement, put it in your sump. You can build a filter and best surface area, way better than any bio ball that can offer. The only difference is if you want a moving bed, these don't move real well. They're pretty much flat positioned. So what I've done in the past is use quilt batting. I've used pot scrubbies, and I've just used, you know, activated carbon in bags, and I've made my own filter using the 3M Rubbermaid, whatever you want to use, plastic drawers, organizing drawers that you buy from a Walmart or Amazon, and simply drill holes in the plastic drawers. So the first drawer will be your quilt batting. Just lay a flat layer of quilt batting. The second drawer will be filled with plastic pot scrubbies, dribbling water like rain over top of the scrubbies, collecting the good bacteria. And then the bottom will essentially be your chemical filtration, your activated carbon if you so choose, or you can even put a UV filter in as long as it's not see-through and you're not having stuff stare at it and bleach from doing it.
And a UV sterilizer will bleach what? It will bleach the...
paint.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yep. Can be damaging. That's why they keep it in black surfaces for a lot of the filters.
Okay.
So this is a great filter. I mean, the whole drawers, they'll cost you $8. The quilt batting, you know, $1.
Or you can get it out of Rob's basement.
Pot scrubbies, a few bucks, getting a few bales of those from the dollar store. And you don't even have to use the activated carbon unless you feel a need for it. Cheapest filter, especially for size. If you have a small, you know, indoor pond, even if you want to trickle outdoors and cover it up, great way to do a filter.
Cheap as heck.
Cheap as heck. Oh, boy. Next is my favorite hack that I discovered when I was at a young age. And these have gotten significantly cheaper. Python is an old brand that allowed you to, as a tool, to change water. It's a plastic piece that you put on the end of your faucet, and instead of siphoning into a bucket and then filling your aquarium back up, which I'm so sick of carrying buckets. If you do anything more than two tanks, it's a nightmare, or a big tank, bucket after bucket after bucket. Save yourself the trouble. Connect a Python, this plastic unit, directly to your sink, and there's a valve on the bottom. You pop the valve open. When you turn the water on your kitchen sink, it will pull water like a vacuum out of your aquarium. So you can literally use a garden hose, maybe attach a cone to the other end of the garden hose and use it as a gravel vacuum. And then, just by putting the valve in the opposite position, it pushes fresh water back into the tank.
Cool.
Literally the best thing since sliced bread.
And make sure that the Python is, the water's on all the time. We actually had somebody on Discord who would shut the water off because they didn't want to waste the water, they thought, and then it wouldn't work. And so make sure it's on while you're draining the entire time. It drains it like 3 times faster.
It uses the power of the water faucet to actually create the vacuum to pull water out. So you have to have the water on to use the Python. And these systems used to cost $150 because it came with just the Python adapter to go to your kitchen sink. It came with a bunch of adjustment valves and hoses. Now they have lowered it to a crazy price. It's like $5-6 on Amazon.
Is it really that cheap?
Really that cheap.
They used to be $40-50 all the time.
So what we're going to do is we're going to take a collaboration of all of our tips and tricks and put it into a document for you so you can follow up after the podcast, and then also have Amazon links to some of the products so you can go ahead and find them.
So you're making it easy for them to buy all this stuff?
Well, hopefully. And also giving them, you know, a few page document to read for funds.
For fun.
For funds. All right. So next, you know, tip is UV sterilizers. To try to purchase a UV sterilizer, hang on the back, you know, in tank UV sterilizer, you're looking at a minimum of like $40. And what they've done is, again, it's just a enclosed unit around a UV bulb, and they have a pump running. So instead, cut the pump out. You already have filters. You have something in a sump or a hang on the back filter. Instead, you can purchase just the UV light that's submergible, like a stick. And they come in, you know, 8-inch, 12-inch sticks, and they're about $10-$12 on Amazon. It's the best thing to use. It has an on and off switch if you don't want to run it all the time. And you simply just set that in your sump, set that on your hang on the back filter, and you already are moving the water cycling across the light. You just got to put it where the water's moving.
And you've got, how many do you have working in your 125-gallon out here?
One.
Just one.
Just
and,
one.
And it's crystal clear.
Crystal clear.
You got over 100 rummy nose in there. You got plants up the wazoo. There's enough in there. Enough plants in there to feed a village, and that water is just crystal clear. And for $10-$12, man, what a great deal!
And I got the smallest one available. I have pretty large hang in the back filter, so I had enough space for a decent sized one. I just grabbed the smallest one. One light covers a massive amount of space. The only time I really can be concerned is if you're doing like a monster tank or a pond. You know, get yourself something sizable. But the warning on this is make sure that number one, your hang in the back filter has a lid. Because if you have no lid, or if it's a see-through type of filter on the hang-on-the-back filter, the UV light will sterilize the paint on your wall. So if you have a color on it, it will eventually bleach out anything it touches. If you have a colored filter, if it's not black, it will bleach out the plastic color.
I need to borrow that because my wife just washed her white shirt the other day with some new clothes that turn it blue. So maybe I could use that.
Just wrap it, you know, leave it for 2 years in a windowsill and just see what happens.
See what happens. I'm going to do that. She'll be excited.
I mean, you should clean it first. That was her goal, but you didn't do laundry.
I didn't clean the turkey baster. I'm not cleaning that.
Oh, man. All right, next thing is sand. So we talked about another episode on different things for beginner setups. You know, pea gravel, sand, and sand is so expensive. You go to any type of, you know, local fish store, even Amazon, to get all these different types of sand. And the only really variation that they give you is color. There's what, black, white, earth tone, and then you have the silly sand, which we don't recommend, which is all painted anyway.
Right. And that paint eventually just wears off.
Right. So instead of putting, you know, gross painted rocks in your aquarium, instead go to your local hardware store and ask for pool filter sand. Pool filter sand is $8 for 50-pound bag, which I guarantee will work for almost any aquarium. You'll have plenty left over. It's dirty, but once you clean it through a bowl, it is pH neutral. It has a beautiful earth tone color, and there's no cheaper gravel substrate you can use.
I hate sand.
I love sand.
I hate sand.
And there will always be a debate between us, but it's amazing. You watch Corydoras sift through it. Watch, you know, dojo loaches or even horseface loaches dig through it.
Or buy 6 or 7 coolie loaches and tell them goodbye. I'll never see them again.
Just poof in the sand forever.
And ever.
And ever.
Sand is bad.
Sand is bad.
Sand is bad. Nobody likes sand but Rob.
So in Minnesota, for the next hack, we don't use chillers.
Why?
Because we're cold up here.
We're always cold.
We're very cold.
I was just kidding.
In the summer, we get 80 and we're all sweating and horrible sitting around the AC unit. But in other areas, such as Texas down south, people use chillers. And, you know, some tanks need it colder. So aquarium chillers can be extremely expensive.
You can buy a refrigerator. A big stand-up refrigerator for the same price as a chiller.
I think the cheapest I've ever found was like $700. Maybe you can squeeze a deal on Amazon, $600. But normal price of those things can go all the way up to $1,300. And they really don't do that great of a job. So here's what I recommend. Go on Craigslist, go on a swap and shop, find yourself an old mini fridge. Especially, you know, after the springtime when college students are coming back and trying to pitch these things, you'll get it for $20 even. So grab yourself an old mini fridge, and again, we don't care about dimensions, smaller, bigger, it doesn't really matter. Just make sure that it runs. So when you get it in, clean it out, plug it in, crank up the coldness all the way, get a 100-foot garden hose, do not uncoil it, just leave it wrapped up, and in either the left or right side walls of the mini fridge, you can drill holes right through the side, about the size of a garden hose, stick both ends of the garden hose through the mini fridge, and you have just built yourself a perfect, better running aquarium chiller than you can buy online.
Yep. One thing I like to do when I buy a new garden hose, I'd like to take it and just run water through it, not knowing if they have any sort of, I don't know, chemical or lubricants that they might have used during processing of making it. And I like to run the water through it for a good half an hour until it cleans out, and then you're good to go.
To adjust temperature really comes down to flow. The slower the flow, the colder the water. The faster the flow, it's not going to be staying in that coil in the fridge as long, so you'll have a easier temperature on your aquarium. But just make sure that when you're drilling the holes that you're not doing it to the top or the back of the mini fridge, because that's where you'll go through the Freon and all the mechanical parts. It will not be fun.
And if you leave that garden hose completely coiled like it is when you buy it at Menards, you actually can put a beer right in the middle of it, and so you'll have a cold beer.
Yeah, just think of it. You spent, let's say, $25 in the garden hose, $25 in the mini fridge. Now you have an amazing aquarium chiller that's better than what you can buy, and a place to put your beer.
Good deal. And cold pizza.
Another problem I have is people get all this type of food. They get the wrong size of pellets. You know, maybe they have a small fish like a guppy, and they have, you know, some sort of high protein cichlid formula. Don't waste money by throwing food away just because it's the wrong size or your fish can't seem to put their mouths around it. Instead, go and find your mom and dad's pepper grinder. Clean it out. Don't leave any pepper in there. If you feed fish pepper, it's not a good deal. And use a pepper grinder. They have an adjustment to show the size of pepper grinds that you want to accomplish, and put any type of food in there. Pellets, wafers, it'll grind it all up nice for you. So you can use it for whatever fish you desire. And also, it allows you to mix your food.
And what's really nice about that, too, is let's say you have a pair of Bristol's Plecos that breed, and all of a sudden you've got babies down there, and now you can just set that grinder down a little bit more and grind it up finally for those babies, and mom and dad and babies will all eat that just fine.
So next tip, and this is where we come in for one of our tips and questions, is leaves. So absolutely use leaves. You know, people are using tropical leaves. Almond leaves are the big thing to purchase, but they're expensive. You have to go online. You get, what, 6 leaves for, you know, sometimes even $2-3 a leaf. It's ridiculous. So instead, stop it. Just stop it. Go outside and look for oak leaves. You can find them seasonally in the fall time, or you can find green ones that you can dry out off the tree if you so want to damage a tree to get leaves for your aquarium. Go outside, find them, take your leaves in. If they're green, let them dry out naturally. If they're already falling off the tree, bake them at 170 degrees. You can do it for roughly 10 minutes. The time frame is, depends on how your oven works. Watch them, because we don't want leaves falling off of the tray and starting a fire in your oven. But after that 10-minute period, you have nice, dried, crispy leaves to put in your aquarium for shrimp purposes, for other fish purposes, for tannins. They make sure they're oak leaves. Don't use others like elm, because, again, I have not personally tried that, and some other forms say there's risks involved. I know oak leaves have some of the similar tannins to almond leaves.
So that works wonderful. Yeah, I use a lot of almond leaves, but I buy almond leaves by the 100-pack, by the 300-pack, and you need to buy a huge amount just to get a decent price. And the other trick, too, when you have an almond leaf that's almost, or an almond leaf or even an oak leaf, when it's almost kind of fallen apart, then you want to start soaking your next one, because the baby shrimp and the baby and the regular shrimp will just devour this thing up so quickly. I have tanks at home that have 200 shrimp, and I'll go through an almond leaf, which is probably 10 inches long, and they'll go through that in a week, and they'll just devour it. There'll be nothing but a skeleton left. So as one's starting to get skeletonized, then you want to get the other one soaking so the bacteria starts to develop, and then the baby shrimp just go crazy on that stuff. Just crazy.
Certainly beats, you can't beat free. Sure, you had to bake it in your oven. Your wife's going to look at you weird, or your mom's going to like, what are you doing baking leaves? It's not pot, Mom. It's just oak leaves for my aquarium. Leave me alone.
Yeah, the other thing, too, in different parts of the country, we don't have it up here in Minnesota, but alder cones can be collected out in the wild. And alder cones are like a really tiny pine cone, but you need to know which ones you're picking. And I've bought alder cones via the internet, and the shrimp love those also. But there again, you want to make sure that you get the correct, because a regular pine cone will skunk up your tank, from what I understand. I've never tried it. The alder cones I like a lot, because they actually hold up a little bit longer.
And make sure that you're doing your best to know if there's sap on them and try to get that off.
Right.
All right, next thing is stop using filter cartridges. If you buy these hang on the back filters or any other filters, stop it. Just next pack, use up your packs. They come with activated carbon, whether you want to use activated carbon or not. Just stop it entirely. What we're going to do is we're going to put a link in the document, and it'll show you can purchase these. It's bio sponge filter media. It's a certain grade of sponge to really trap all the particulates. And these comes in you know, sizable sheets. I think we have one that is, you know, 23 inches. So you'll get these sheets cut to fit the back of your hang in the back filter, and just use those. These types of sponges that will link you allow you to reuse and clean the sponge rather than continually change cartridges all the time and have the polyester on the cartridge fall apart.
Yeah, and you can take those, you know, when you buy that big sheet, you want to just cut like two or three, so when you pull one out to rinse it out, you can add a fresh one, you can just pop in there, rinse the other one out, let it dry, and you're good to go, as long as you don't disrupt the filter too much, because if you leave that filter's got all kinds of great bacteria in it, just by changing out the sponge or the filter, you'll still have good bacteria in there to break down the waste.
And what I've seen people do is they leave one, because normally these hang-in-the-back filters, they'll have two slots and bigger hang-in-the-back filters. So what they'll do is just to make sure that the, you know, biological bacteria accumulates in the sponge, is they will take out only one, leave one of the gross bad ones in, and then put the sponge in on the other side to collect over time. And then once it finally collects on one, then you can take the other out.
Perfect.
All right. So when I met you, Jimmy, you had all these tanks everywhere from different warehouse operations and broken tanks. And, you know, when I needed a tank, I went to Jimmy's house and he's like, yeah, help yourself to a tank. They're all, you know, stained, calcium stains across them, and they're no good. Well, they're not no good, but Jimmy didn't have time to go through a pile of tanks with a razor blade and try to individually scrape and clean these off and watch his fingers fall apart.
I'd rather donate blood.
He'd rather donate blood than scrape
through
calcium
eyeballs
off an aquarium glass. So I took them, and I started cleaning them, and sure enough, my fingers almost wanted to feel like they were going to fall off my own hand, and I was getting real sick of it. So I did some research and trying to figure out what could you use that was aquarium safe. And I tried everything. I bought all these different chemicals from every website I could try, spent a lot of money, and really didn't get a lot of great results. Basically, some of them gave me like some goo coating that would just make the razor blade essentially slide better. It wouldn't actually clean the tank. Instead, this is actually a shout out to the king of DIY, Joey. He had a special episode where he had a hint of cleaner that he was using called Barkeeper's Friend.
It's a nickel. It is cheap.
It's like $4 for a giant container of it, and you'll never, ever use it all. A tiny bit on a sponge, and it simply just wipes all that buildup right off. You know, calcium buildup, brown buildup, any of that, you know, whitish film buildup, it cleans right off, and just make sure to do a nice rinse, and it does rinse very clean.
Yeah, and you can pick that up at your local big box store, just over in the cleaning supplies, called Barkeeper's Friend. It's good stuff. When Rob showed me that, I let him clean a couple hundred aquariums, and I asked for them all back, and I never got them back.
They're just gone forever.
Forever gone.
Forever and ever. All right, so I get people saying, oh, I want to do a fish tank, but I want to go on vacation. I want to feed them. I don't want to call people up to feed my fish. Well, if you're going on vacation, use an automatic fish feeder. And it's not like it used to be. The original automatic fish feeders were literally a clock motor. So you'd clamp this weird plastic thing to the back from the 70s, and it would literally have the same clock motor you see on just a normal wall-hanging clock, and it would just feed them twice a day. They have much improved these systems. They're digital. You can choose a schedule. You can choose spot checks. Some of them are Bluetooth, but we have a very cheap hang on the back aquarium fish feeder for you to check out. These are great, but I have a warning on these as for a tip. Don't use them all the time, because people get lazy and just, oh, I'm just going to let them auto feed. No, your feeding time with your fish is the time to, you know, look at their activity. Check for colorations, check for breeding patterns, and above all else, check the overall health of your fish. If they're not eating correctly or if something's happening, the time is when you're feeding them and you're going to catch that. You're going to see the ick. You're going to see the fungus start growing. You're going to see if they're egg bound. That's your time with your fish. So only strictly use these when you're gone. I can't stress that enough. I've seen too many people, oh, my fish just up and died. Well, it's had a hole in the head for 3 weeks.
Or else, you know, the thing that when people use them all the time, all of a sudden you forget that, well, the thing's been spinning empty for 2 weeks and nobody's gotten fed. You know, we do some tank maintenance at a hospital in a nearby town. And that thing will continually spin and feed the fish twice a day. But every once in a while, when you get a high humidity day, let's say the sun comes in through the window and hits that tank, and that tank heats up and you get more humidity, sometimes that feeder, the food inside of it, will get kind of sticky. And then all of a sudden, it just turns into a clump of crud, and it's not feeding. It's still spinning. It's still tumbling, but nothing's coming out. So, yeah, to use it on an everyday basis is kind of tough. But, you know, when people are doing tank maintenance and stuff, they do that. And that's why a lot of people use pellets, because they have less tendency to stick together.
So getting towards the end of my list here, but the next one is, you've seen a lot of people have sumps for their aquarium where they have their filters, all their other pieces. And that's where generally people put plants in their sumps to try to remove, you know, the gross entities from the tank, help beneficial bacteria. But I encourage you, if you have a hang on the back filter, put plants in that thing. Take the lid off. If you don't have a UV filter stuck in your hang on the back filter, take the lid off, and you can start with something easy. Bamboo shoots are a great plant to put in the back. They're semi-aquatic, so you can completely submerge them if you really have to, and just stick a couple bamboo pieces in the back. I've seen other people put small trays and have other plants in there. I've even seen spider plants hang on the back of the hang on the back filter. The only concern you need to worry about is that the roots don't overtake and block the filter. But if you're checking your filter cartridges, you're going to be able to catch roots by the time your filter cartridge clogs up. Plants do not grow that fast.
Right, but when the bamboo shoots grow too big, then you go outside and you feed them to your favorite panda. Do you have pandas here?
Pandas are illegal.
Pandas are illegal, man.
In Minnesota?
No.
Just everywhere.
What you collect just them, everywhere. And you bring them to the Red River Zoo, and you bring them to the red panda.
Oh, red pandas. So right. I cannot keep a panda in my backyard. There are so many rules. I just don't like this at all.
You don't. That's what you get for being a fish importer.
So I am not going to feed the bamboo to the pandas.
You'll feed them to me, and we'll have them at Who Hunts in small pieces.
We'll have a salad. Perfect.
Small pieces. All right. The last couple things that I want to talk to you about. I'm a tech guy by trade. That has been my career. I've been an IT professional for over 11, 12 years. And the fish hobby has not jumped leaps and bounds using a lot of technology. So for those that are tech savvy, I encourage you to use some of these Alexa or Google devices for your aquarium. And here's a couple examples. Number one, people use the automated light. What are those called? They're antique. You put them on a clock and they shut your light off during the night and then turn on during the day.
Oh, just like an old timer.
Yeah, it's like an antique timer. So you can use them.
Anything over 5 years old is antique to Rob's.
Well, I'm sorry, but if you plug something into a light socket and it's got a ton of buttons that go around, just physical mechanical buttons, and it doesn't even give you a screen, it bothers me.
How do you even get to work in the morning?
I don't know, but what you can do is you can get these, what they call smart plugs. Essentially, just plug in your wall outlet, and it mirrors a wall outlet. It just controls the power on and off. So you can set these up in a relay so you can plug your lights or extra lights into a smart plug, your UV light, if you want to shut it on and off and not have it run 24 hours a day. You can plug it into your hang-in-the-back filters or pumps. And what you can do is simply walk up to your Alexa and go, Alexa, it's time to feed fish. And they go, okay. And then it shuts off your hang-in-the-back filter, turns on an extra light so the fish can see, and the fish already know that, oh, pump shut off, it's time for food, and they're up to the top. You feed them. 15 minutes later, it automatically turns back on. So go ahead and just take time, look at these smart plugs. They're really easy to set up through either Alexa or Google. They're really, really cheap. You can get a bunch of these smart plugs for, you know, 20, you can, I think a three pack is like 25, 30 bucks. And check them out. It's really handy dandy.
My Alexa's too stupid. She'll just feed them pizza.
Just feed them pizza? Well, you have to feed them unless you have some sort of smart enabled auto feeder. Don't do that.
I don't have Facebook. How would I know this? God, I hate you both today.
That's okay. Old man Colby over there.
Oh.
The last thing on my list is cameras. So people have been looking at cameras for fish tanks for a long time. People buy GoPro to stick in their aquarium to scare the living hell out of their fish to take a image. Instead, I recommend, it's called WyzeCam. W-Y-Z-E. These are home security cameras. They're really small, and they're 20 bucks.
And they are high quality.
High quality. They have unlimited cloud support for 12-second clips. The idea is you're supposed to put them in the, you know, your front entryway, your garage door. And if UPS walks up to their door, you can essentially catch them on camera destroying your box in the front of your house.
Kicking it all the way from the curb to your door.
but you can use these and put them to the side of your aquarium. So if you're trying to watch how a breeding process is doing from work, it's $20.
$20.
The best $20 you can use for your camera just for your fish.
Can you turn it on so it's on all the time?
It's on 24 hours a day, and if the light's off, it has night vision mode, which kind of works in the aquarium. I've used them personally. They'll catch movement, they'll catch bits and pieces, but it really relies on your water clarity.
So this would work really well. I had a pair of angelfish that would lay eggs. They'd lay 300 eggs, and I usually try to leave them in there for a few hours to make sure everything's fertilized and stuff, and then the female would just spend all the time trying to defend the eggs. And I had one male that would continuously, he was like a little kamikaze. He'd come in and get 10 eggs at a time, and she'd fend him off. So I had one of these cameras from Rob, and I put it on there. And so I was upstairs watching TV, and I could see that they were almost done breeding. The egg slate was pretty full. And at that point, I decided to go down there and take away the eggs, because now that whole slate is full. And if I would have waited another hour, he would have probably ate them all. So one slate of eggs, probably 250, 300 babies, it paid for my entire system right there, just in baby fish.
Snap and you're set.
Yep.
You can set dimensions on the camera. So you can set the camera to, if as long as something swims by the slate or in front of the slate, it'll do a 12-second clip and send an alert to your phone. Now, it can easily spam, but if you put that slate into a corner of the tank where fish never go, then suddenly, boop, you look, oh, guess what, they're breeding. And now you have an alert push to your phone. It's crazy. All for $20. There's no monthly fee for this either.
And all my stupid fish, I don't know, for some reason, they all decided they want to breed about 9, 10, 11 o'clock at night, just as I'm going to bed, because I'm an early riser, unlike Rob's. I get up in the morning and go to work. And Rob, he sleeps in until like 8 o'clock.
Well, yeah, but the thing is, it's your fault. So when you're starting to play Marvin Gaye upstairs, they hear that and they're in the mood.
Now, I'll explain to these young people who Marvin Gaye is.
Oh, don't worry. Right here is where we're going to put an audio clip of Marvin Gaye.
Oh.
Played for you now. I've been really trying,
baby. Trying to hold back this feeling for so long.
All right, how was that? Was that not the best?
That was sexy.
That was some sexy stuff.
Sexy stuff.
My panties are off right now.
Oh, my God.
Yes, sir.
I'm leaving the building.
Oh. All right, so that is my list.
I'm down here.
That is my list.
Hey, Adam's alive. All right.
It's your turn, Adam.
Adam, how are you doing?
Well, pretty good.
How are things at Wabasha?
Adam's loins are frothing from that audio clip.
I know. The father of four. No, how was trick-or-treating, buddy, with the kids?
It was pretty good. It was like the fastest trick-or-treating ever. I just brought them down one street, and they loaded up on candy, and we were done.
So speed trick-or-treating, kind of like speed dating, but speed trick-or-treating?
Yes, and it's way better to do that.
Were they like Wilford Brimley and just walk up, like,
diabetes,
and then they just gave you candy?
No, in Wabasha, we have what's called 12th Street, and it's basically like a block and a half where both sides, everybody goes trick-or-treating on this street. So you just literally, the kids run from one door to the next, and everybody has candy, and then the cops are walking down the street because there's all these little kids running around. They're handing out candy, and people throw candy out of their cars at kids, and they just load up on candy, and they're done.
Man, that doesn't even allow for razor blades anymore. If what? Cops walking down the street.
That's the point.
Oh, that is the point, yes. Rob is not a parent.
Yes.
Hey, I have a lot of fish that call me daddy.
Yeah, everybody calls you daddy. So how many pounds of candy do the kids get?
Oh, I think between the four of them, it was like 18 pounds of candy. It
all
was
right.
Ridiculous.
Diabetes.
Hey.
Diabetes.
Sure. Secret time. How much did you steal? Tell me.
Oh, dad tax is at least half.
Dad tax? What the hell is dad
half?
Tax? Oh,
dad tax? You never use dad tax?
I've never used dad tax.
This is how I teach my kids about taxes.
Oh.
I take their candy, and then I say, it's taxation, and they go, but you stole it. I said, exactly, that's what taxation is.
Good. Teach them to hate the government at 8 years old.
Wow.
Look at you.
You are something else.
The youngest one is two.
Did you dress up like Uncle Sam or Trump? Just be like, nope, that's for the wall.
We aren't getting politicky.
Oh, man.
Teaching them taxes.
Just teaching them taxes. Well, perfect. So what do you have for us for tips, tricks, and tipsters and whistleblower?
Hacks.
Oh, hacks.
Hacks.
Are you the whistleblower? I'm just curious.
No, I'm not.
Donald Trump says you know who the whistleblower is.
It's not a whistle. It's a didgeridoo and didgeridon't.
Oh, is this my time to blow the didgeridoo?
Go ahead, Jim.
Adam, God. It sounds dead now.
I'm not very good.
Oh, no. Adam, please.
It's not going very good, Adam.
Give us a tip.
All right.
Oh, he just shit in the mic.
Rock on.
There we go.
Oh, that's a duck for sure.
Hurry up,
oh,
please.
Oh, man. All right, your turn.
Okay, so if you have a lot of fish tanks.
I do.
In my pet store, I had, I want to say like 75 tanks. On everything but the salt water and the goldfish, I had sponge filters. And my electric bill dropped almost $400 in 1 month just by switching all of my back filters into sponge filters, and it worked a lot better. They literally sent somebody from the power company because they couldn't figure out why the power bill dropped so much.
Wait. So you're telling me that like XL Energy just shows up and be like, yo, are you stealing?
Actually, it was the Grand Rapids, Minnesota Public Works employee. He came in and was looking around to make sure, and he goes, we noticed that your power dropped. And I go, yeah, I changed all the filters because I had a big blower.
So you had back filters is what you had, right?
Yeah, I had hang on the back filters.
So you had
in every single tank.
75 of those things hanging and sucking up big power, right?
Yep. And I switched that to just sponge filters, and power bill dropped. The other thing that I did is I switched all my hang on the back filters as they would break to fully submersible heaters, and then I would hang them sideways.
Why'd you do that?
And the reason why you hang them sideways is because the heat rises, and if you hang it sideways, you're putting more heat to go straight up. Instead of having it go in a narrow area, it goes in like that 4 to 5 inch or 6 inch area, and it goes straight up. And then if you have a hang on the back filter, for those that have only a couple of couple tanks, you put your aquarium heater sideways underneath the flow of your filter, and it'll disperse the heat more evenly around your tank. And if you really want to see how your filter disperses the flow rate, take a small pinch of fish food, put it in the outtake of your filter, you know, where the water comes out of your filter, and you can actually see where the water goes, and you can see if you have any dead zones in your tank, and then you can add a bubbler to that spot or anything else that you might need. Also, to grow your fish faster, South American fish need water changes, like massive amounts of water changes, like your discus, your angelfish,
clean
guppies,
water.
That type of stuff.
They oh, I thought you were going to say reggae.
What? No.
Yeah, they need reggae music?
Reggae?
No.
Have you
they
ever tried
water
it?
Water changes.
You've never
well,
tried
I've
it.
I've never tried that.
Okay, so you don't know.
Just We got to do the research.
All right. Maybe yes. If you get a grant.
Just no didgeridoos.
Oh.
No didgeridoos.
You people.
But I found this out from an older guy who used to breed fish. African fish need current. So on my African cichlid tanks that were for a store display, on a 20-gallon long, I would put a 280-gallon per hour filter. And for the first 2 days, it just bats them around and they find little spots to go and hide from the current. But they grow like 3 or 4 times faster with current than without.
Well, that makes sense. If you look at, you know, Americans, right? They grow a bit more muscle when on a treadmill.
Yes, exactly.
Right?
Yeah, I've heard this many times before. And then when Adam told me, I went, oh, poof, and then I got to his store because I used to supply his store. And yeah, I mean, a lot of those people do that. By feeding these things, and the thing is, of course, the warmer the water and the more water flow, the faster they grow. And also with the water, like Adam said, with the clean water, these fish, as they grow, they absorb calcium from the water for bone development. And once that water, all the calcium's out of the water, then they quit growing.
Whoa. So what you're saying is that if you see a dead deer carcass, cut a bone out.
Yes.
Chop it up, put it in your aquarium?
Absolutely.
That's the way to do it, yes.
Not a recommended hack. I was kidding.
Oh.
Need to point that out. There okay. might be someone that... all right, I'm not going to mention who, right? But I decided as a joke on a fish forum that someone was talking about their Placo, and I was just trying to make a joke to make a little lighter the situation because clearly he was upset that his Placo died. And I said, well, you know, what am I supposed to do now that it's dead? I don't know how to take care of the fish. Well, most of the time you just tell him, well, politely flush it down the toilet. You know, because it'll decompose. It's a safe spot. It's not going to hit an open waterway to, you know, cause disease. Toilet is a good place. But I just put, you know, you need to do a Viking funeral for him?
What's a Viking funeral?
A Viking funeral is where they put the corpse in a boat, right?
They
float it, and they light the boat on fire until it.
Oh my God!
You falls apart. And
you've got too much time on your hands.
I'm not gonna say who it was, just for the sake of their identity. But they sent me a video like a week later saying, "Here it is." I'm like, "What?" Sure shit, there's a little Pleco on a paper like origami boat under a bed of matches, and they push it off, and it's in this giant Rubbermaid tote of water. And they push it off, and they light it on fire, and sure enough, it falls apart, and the whole Viking funeral thing. And there was music behind it. They did a good job, but don't. I my words are powerful on especially places like these podcasts, so I need to be very careful in what I say. I had no idea they'd take me seriously.
Why
it
would
was
your
a
mom?
Joke.
Why would your mom do that?
My mom did not do that.
Okay, whatever.
It was someone I can't mention, though. Not related.
Anybody I know?
They'll know when they listen to it.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Is it anybody I know?
Probably not.
Oh, darn.
Right.
Because I there's nothing more fun than making fun of your friends.
Oh, man.
Man, so many fish nerds. What else you got, Adam?
All right. So the other thing that I would do is I would always soak my frozen food in garlic. Because I was dealing with a lot of fish from different wholesalers.
Like garlic juice? Or?
Wait. I know you're ethnic, but I didn't know you're Italian.
No, I'm not Italian. It's a Sea Kim Garlic Guard is what it's called.
Oh, so it's nothing you make up in a blender. It's something you buy.
Yeah, it's something that I bought.
Oh, we're going to put a link on this.
Yeah, there'll be a link. And you can actually buy it in, like, I think 5 gallon or, like, 2 gallon jugs. They sell it in different sizes. This stuff was the only thing that I found that worked. I used it for my salt water because I would always get problems. It was a food attractant. Everybody would go to it. They seem to eat a little faster when and more intrigued with food, especially new fish.
It's an appetite stimulant.
Appetite stimulant.
Is that how pasta gets you? It's the garlic in it that makes you want to eat more?
It's the garlic. Yes. We eat lots of pasta here.
Damn it, Bobby.
And then I had read that garlic builds up in the fish's slime coat and it helps prevent them from getting ick.
Interesting.
I can't say for 100% that it worked, but I will say that I almost never had it in my tanks, and it was because I would do bi-weekly dosings of garlic. Most of my fish wouldn't stay there long enough anyways, but the garlic, the allicin, I think is what it's called, or eliacin or whatever, in the food builds up in their slime coat, and supposedly ick can't go into it. I just noticed a general improvement in fish health by doing it. It was one of the few things that I could do to control from suppliers and everything else, and that it would work.
So I've heard a lot of crazy remedies from garlic. Quick story. Growing up, went to church, and there was always these nutty people at church that were always crazy about health. And when you went up to them, they didn't smell like they put on their, you know, church best. They smelled like rotten garlic all the time. Their breath reeked of it. Even when their mouth was closed, they didn't say a word. You just smell an aura of garlic on them at all times. And I just kind of like, oh, they're just the weird people at church, and kind of just let them be by the wayside. And garlic would always just repulse my mom. She'd always complain about it after we'd go home from church. Oh, they're just so gross. And I noticed when we were out on a church camp event, everybody was getting just eaten alive by mosquitoes, but these two weirdos that smelled like garlic. And I'm like, light bulb, I love garlic. Garlic tastes delicious. So I just went out and went full on ham. And I just started eating, you know, garlic cloves on toast, garlic pills, anything I could just to see if it worked.
This explains why you're single for so long.
That summer, I never got bit by a mosquito. So, proof in point.
Wow.
Feed your fish so they don't get bit by mosquitoes.
Actually right now, if you see that they sell garlic pills for people for overall health, or how do you say that? I'm just saying it wrong.
For their
overall health. There we go.
You need garlic clearly for your cognitive function.
Exactly. So Adam, quick question. Does this work on freshwater fish and saltwater fish?
Yes. I used it on both. Then I also heard that it was used as a dewormer for fish, but I never really got anything that was wild, so I didn't notice it. With a lot of the fish that I liked, like elephant noses and loaches and stuff, you can't really use copper for treating stuff. So I just used garlic on everything, and it worked great, and the garlic never hurt the live rock for my saltwater fish. Mandarin gobies liked the food back when you could, before ORA started captive breeding them. It just, garlic guard always seemed to help. I used that and I sold just tons of it because it was such a big help.
Yeah, and it helps when you believe in a product and you promote it to your customers. But I do know one thing it does not work on. And you know what that is, Adam?
Didgeridoos?
No, Vampire Plecos.
Probably.
Yeah, Vampire Plecos do not like garlic.
Oh, the jokes.
What? It's true.
That's like all of our,
you know what, let's call out Jim Kitchen, you know, the Pleco King that we had on last week, and let's verify this. We'll get him on the phone here, and we'll verify that.
Are you saying vampire swordtails don't like it either?
Exactly.
Vampire crabs.
Exactly.
There's a lot of vampire creatures. Right? I just on the top of my head, right?
Yeah,
there.
That was good.
Be proud of me.
Wow, that was good.
We're gonna call you Buffy the Fish Slayer.
I'm gonna punch you in the throat.
Where's that didge? I want up.
You're not touching my didgeridoo because I kind of got a cold and I don't want to give you a cold.
I don't want the gym herpes.
No, it's not herpes.
Well, what's that thing on your lip?
No, it's a hairpiece, not a herpes. Okay. My Lord, this has gone south in a quick hurry.
Adam, you got more for us.
What more you got, Adam?
All right, Microblift Special Blend. That is the, it's basically, I call it crap in a bottle, to be nice. Because when you
doo-doo in a bottle? Lid,
wait, tea time. Huh? Is this the stuff that they had on the podcast with Ohio Fish Rescue he got high on the back?
No. That's something else.
Oh, okay. I was getting excited.
No,
that was prime.
There you go.
That was prime, yeah.
Still smells bad.
Yeah, that smells bad. This literally smells like open sewage.
Ooh.
Do not use it if you have open cuts on your hand. Don't get it on a cut. It will get infected.
Don't use it for aftershave.
Don't use it for aftershave. You take it, and what I would do with my customers if they had new tanks is I would get them, have them bring like a cup or two and fill it with some poop water basically from the bottom of one of my tanks.
Is that what you market it as? Cup oh shit?
No, now we need more ducks. It was basically that.
you know what? For this, when a bad word comes out, we'll use a didgeridoo.
Oh my god!
Yeah, that word.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah,
that's gonna be better.
All right, what else?
So what you do is you fill up your tank. You take your cup of crap or whatever. You pour that in there. You put your filter in. If you really had to get fish in there that day, and then you take you let it all settle, and then the next day you take the microblift and you follow the directions on the bottle, you pour that in there, and your tank is instantly set. Don't cram like 50 fish in a 10-gallon tank or anything crazy like you're not supposed to. But if you wanted to throw two or three fish in there right away, you could put the microblift in it, and it works great. So I had no problems with that.
So it kickstarts your tank to go to 100.
Pretty much. And it's like if you need it to go... Say you have you don't have a backup tank or your tank broke or something and you need to move it and you can't get all the water out. It just helps. It's something good to have, but it literally smells. So, and don't let it freeze because if it freezes, all the bad bacteria dies.
Then you have worthless crap. You don't have good
crap.
Then
you have worthless crap, yeah.
Quack, quack.
Yeah. All right. Got anything else?
I got two more things.
Ooh.
Mellifix.
No. Oh, hold on.
Nobody likes
No.
Nobody likes Mellifix.
Mellifix works.
All right. Mellifix is like you just went to your local health food co-op and you walked in and that pungent, nasty hippie smell hit you in the face.
No.
And they put it in a bottle.
This is tea tree oil.
All right.
This stuff works. But there's a trick to it. The reason why it comes in a blue bottle is because light degrades it. So you have to make sure that when you're using this, you remove your activated charcoal and everything else, and you put it in there, and you shut the aquarium lights off. If you need to cover it with a towel so that no light gets in for the treatment, that's what you do. I use this religiously at my store because I was trying to use as many natural medicines as I could.
Hippie.
It worked, and I didn't have a problem with the fish, and I didn't lose that many fish. Jim will testify to that. He was always mad because I wasn't buying extra fish because my fish didn't die from him. That also means he's a good supplier, but still.
You're a hippie.
Yeah. But make sure the lights are off with the Mellifix.
So if you go to Mellifix's website and find they have sunglasses for your aquarium with an extra ponytail you can put in the hang on the back filter.
I did not know that. Secret type. Is this the stuff, Adam, that smells like Vicks VapoRub?
Yes, it smells. Remember, you came into my store and I was treating a couple tanks with it, and you said, "What the hell stinks in here?"
I said, "Do you have a cold? Did your mama did your mama put Vicks on your chest before you came to work?"
But no, that's what I used, and that's why it works, and that's what I found works. But everybody, like, it never worked until I shut the lights off, and the only reason why I found that out is because I called them, and they were like, "Well, the reason why you put it in a blue bottle is because the light degrades it."
And they said, "Did you read the directions, dum dum?"
No, it's not even on the directions. That's the problem. Well, that's how they sell. It was never on the directions.
That must be how they sell a lot of it, then, is don't give you directions.
Yeah.
Because there was a PemaFix, there's a PemaFix and a Melafix, correct?
Yeah.
One was for something and one was for getting high. I don't know what it is.
Melafix was for, like, fin rot, fish fungus, that type of stuff. The slime, the white fungusy stuff that you see on them. And I only use that one. I never used the PemaFix at all. But the Melafix I liked, and it always worked really good.
So what's your last one?
Titanium grounding probes. And you guys will laugh at me.
We do all the time anyway.
Yeah, I know.
Can it get better than Melafix?
It will.
So what's it called again?
It's called a titanium grounding probe.
Oh, and I saw this on Back to the Future when they're trying to get that car going at 88 miles an hour.
I've never seen that movie. Oh,
when you hear the word probe, know that it's not that probe.
No.
Right.
Yes. What it is it's this metal rod that you put in your aquarium, and then you plug the other end into your outlet, and you ground it, and you screw the screw of your outlet.
Hold on, we need to restart. You plug it into your wall outlet, correct? Yes. Okay. Whew. All right, I'm good.
Rob is sweating over there. This little sweat bead came right down his forehead. He's like, "This."
All right.
This reminds me of when I went to the proctologist.
Okay, so I had problems because I used to have a lot of discus and big discus, and I had a cracked heater, and it electrocuted everything in my damn tank. I lost L46 zebra plecos. I lost discus that were the size of dinner plates. I was in tears, and then I called Jim looking for L46, and they died like the week before they put them on CITES too, so you couldn't get them from Brazil anymore. Cheap. You remember that.
Yeah.
You laughed at me.
Yeah.
Because I had a mated pair.
Yeah, it was funny.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't mine.
Yeah, that's exactly it, because it wasn't yours. But I put one of those in there, and I've put them in all my tanks with discus, angelfish, that type, South Americans, Oscars. And it absorbs the stray electricity. It's supposed to help with hole in the head, but that could be parasites, charcoal. I've heard of a dozen different things. I just, for your high-end fish, I always put it in there. That way, if you have a cracked heater or something, it will suck up electricity and you can hopefully catch it in time.
So it's a lightning rod for your aquariums that have shitty heaters.
Holy gigawatts.
All heaters are technically shitty if you really want to get into it.
I guess.
You know, I have not found a really good one. The plastic ones leak. The glass ones can crack. The ones with the cages on them, I don't know. Every heater can suck.
Insurance policies.
Yeah. I heard rumors, and I don't know if anybody out there is listening, somebody told me they're coming out with LED heaters.
Yes, and infrared as well.
Well, LED takes so much less electricity, but anything that draws a lot of power or that creates heat draws a lot of power. I mean, look at the difference between a 60-watt light bulb that's been, you know, on for 3 hours. If you go in there to unscrew it, you burn your fingertips off, whereas a 60-watt like LED bulb is very, very cool. But somebody said that they're coming out with an LED heater. I've looked everywhere for them.
They're an infrared style heater, and they're really not mass marketed yet.
So is it going to save me electricity, Robs?
It should. It should save you drastic amounts of electricity.
So why can't I find these?
Because we're not in China yet.
And so it's secret time.
It's secret time.
Oh, in China.
Right.
Figures.
Everything in time.
So let's hope that something like that comes out, because that's probably one of your biggest draws of electricity now in your tank is your heater.
Well, thank you, Adam. So, Jimmy, it's your turn.
What do I got?
Well, number one, you should start with not using heaters at all.
I like heat in the room, personally. I mean, most of my tips that I have are for multi-tanks. We're going to do a podcast later on about setting up a fish room, which I've done probably 7 or 8 fish rooms in my life. And every time you put one up, you learn a little bit something and how to...
And he's not just meaning some, like, dedicating one room. He means warehouses. Like, you're going to put up some tanks, put a wall up. I mean, dedicate a lot of different tanks. It's not just, like, you know, 5 tanks at your house. It's a room.
At one time, I had over 400 tanks. But like right now, we're only running maybe 40 tanks downstairs in our basement. And the whole thing is when we crank up our, like if we have to put heaters in the tanks, it just runs our electricity bill through the goddamn roof. So, I mean, you're best off just trying to heat that room and keep it closed off, keeping it tight. So that's the way to go. So anyway, most of my tips that I have are for a fish room. So if you have multiple tanks and you want to save some money, don't go out and buy yourself a regular type of stand. Make yourself a stand out of 2x4s and 3.5-inch carriage bolts. There's a lot of good videos on YouTube showing you how to make your own fish stands for your, and you can make them whatever size you need. All I say is that when you do it, make it out of 2x4s, you can do a huge 8-foot rack for probably $25-$30. And make sure you paint it when you're done, just for the fact that you don't want it to mold or mildew, because it is going to get wet.
And if you're carpentry inept like myself, I literally have a handicap where I physically cannot put two pieces of wood together, you can go out and try to purchase yourself a pallet rack. They have metal pallet racks. They're definitely more expensive than the wood options, but they're also pretty cheap. If you're trying to make a stand that holds hundreds of pounds or thousands of pounds, depending on how many quorums you're putting on this thing, small pallet racks work excellent.
Yeah, that's what we currently are using now in our basement, is we're using pallet racks just for the fact that every time I think I'm done, I will then jerk all the tanks off and then rearrange them into a different. And with the pallet racking, is you're able to adjust each shelf, and it makes it so much easier. And it holds up to 2,000 to 3,000 pounds per shelf, so you can put a lot on there. Next one I have is sponge filters, like Adam's been talking to, but I make my own sponge filters. You can buy them fairly cheap on the internet. I like to make my own. I buy a 4-inch poly foam. I get it from my local Hobby Lobby. Do not use the green foam, because that is a flame retardant foam and that will kill your fish. So you buy a 24x24-inch sheet of sponge filter, and you can, I think they sell them as cushion, like cushion.
Well, I keep making the joke that when you make these sponge filters, you cut them out of Cadillacs, and that's essentially what it is.
I'm not taking it out of somebody's car seat, no.
Well, I mean, not your car seat.
Right.
Someone else's.
Exactly. So out of a 24-inch by 24-inch, you can cut them into 4-inch, so a 4-inch square, and you do a lift tube out of a piece of PVC, and then take a piece of 4-inch tile and silicone it to the bottom. I'm making them from about 75 cents, and when I make them, I'll do 40 or 50 at a time just to have them on standby. What I also like to do is have maybe 30 sponge filters in a 110-gallon vat constantly going. So all of a sudden, I decide I'm going to rearrange my tanks, and now I need 6 more filters. I have them all ready to go. I just drop them in. They're already seated. They're already ready to go.
And when he says ready to go, it's not necessarily cycled, which that it does. He keeps the sponges cycled. But when you're putting a new sponge in, even with the tile to hold it down, sometimes the air in the sponge can cause it to float. And when it floats and you have a tube sticking out of it, that means water on the floor.
It's like 25 little squirt guns squirting all over the place.
Continually.
The other thing I like to buy to save money is I buy my airline tubing in 500-foot rolls. And it is so much cheaper to buy a 500-foot roll. I then make a little stand out of PVC, so it actually sits there, and I can pull it off, cut it with the scissors. I personally like the silicone airline tubing because it stays real soft for a very long, long time.
So also you can use this in a ghetto pinch to use it as just cord to tie stuff with. I was putting a weird type of filter, and the foam wouldn't fit in, so I just cut off a piece of airline tube, tied it around, and now it's my quick rope, because it's that cheap when you buy 500 feet.
So again, trying to save money, when I'm starting my little fish room, I run one air pump, and I use 1.5-inch PVC that comes off that air pump, and I have the PVC connected to the roof all the way around, and they all have little stainless steel air controllers, and you can buy those air controllers on the internet for about $1.59, and each one is very controlled, and you can control each tank to the point where you could have just a little bit of flow, or you could have it boiling. So it's wonderful. So anyway,
so what kind of pumps are those? Because they're not just specific piston pumps. They have a special adapter, and they're built for doing multiple tanks.
Right.
And so what's a brand that you've used?
I like the Ultima, and that is my favorite brand that I use. And Rob will put up a link on the website for that. And there are several different sizes, and it will tell you in there that this particular size will do 30 tanks, or this particular size will do 50 tanks. So pick out the size you need. I always like to you know, if I got 50 tanks, I'm going to buy one that does 75 tanks just for the fact it's nice to have a little extra air. You can bleed it off if you want and have no back pressure. But also, they're very inexpensive to run, having one air pump to run 40 tanks, and it makes so much more sense just to run that one thing that's plugged in versus having, like Adam said, having all the back filters plugged in for each individual tank.
So I tried to, because these are not exactly a cheap pump. These are, you know, $150 pump.
Yes.
So I was trying to see if there's other ways that I could get around that and creating another fish room myself. And I purchased these massive outdoor pond pumps. And these things are not meant, they're meant to handle quite a few different connections, but not like 50. They're meant to handle many, many feet of line so you can have a single air stone in the bottom of a 6-foot pond. Because, again, the deeper it is, the harder it is to push air. So I bought one of these, got a massive, you know, 20-end adapter, and the pump was so violent and pushed out so much air, it blew the whole end off, like exploded the whole tip.
And it was very noisy also.
Very noisy. It was not near the quality. So I have to say this is the way to go if you're going over 10 connections.
Especially when you're having it inside your house and you don't want that. I mean, when we sit in
you
our...
You want to sleep at night.
Right. When we sit in our sunroom, we can hear, like, water boiling downstairs because we've got 30, 40 tanks set up. And but you don't hear the pump. You just hear the water moving. So that's what I like to use, as those particular pumps. They've always done well for me. And you can get a replacement kit for it when the little diaphragm will wear out. You can get that for about $30. And it's a very quick and easy fix, and I just keep one on hand, and I think they'll last 4, 5, 6 years. I've had them last, and then all of a sudden, you got no air, and it takes 15 minutes to fix it, and you're up and running again. The other one I like to do is I don't like to buy glass tops for my tanks because it's too goddamn expensive. So I like to do is I buy the glass up at the local hardware store. I usually get 1/8 inch or 1/4 inch, depending on what size tank I have. They'll you can tell them what size you want it cut to. They'll cut it for you. I do the front. I usually do about 6 inches by the width of the tank. And the back, I always leave about 1 inch left so we can put airline hoses and stuff. But if you go online, you can find a 6-foot hinge, just that plastic hinge that you get with your tanks. And you can cut that hinge with a hacksaw. And you get 2 pieces of glass and one of these hinges. And you can do your whole glass top for under $3.
And the glass, again, you go to your local hardware store. Almost every hardware store that you have in your local community will cut you panes of glass to replace for windows, for any other accessory. And it costs like $2 for them to go cut whatever size pane of glass you want. Just when you get it, they're not going to, you know, touch up the glass. They're just going to give you a cut pane of glass. So make sure to take some sandpaper and gently rub the edges. Otherwise, you'll have sliced open fingers. I learned this the very hard way. Jimmy's like, oh, make sure to put some sandpaper on. What? And then I sliced my finger as he said it.
Yeah, you want to use either low grit sandpaper or emery cloth. But I've also scratched glass being too fast. You just want to hit the edges. And it doesn't take much. Probably about a minute, minute and a half. And you can smooth out those edges so you don't get cut on them. But emery cloth is a great thing. And you'll save yourself a ton of money because Rob, what is a glass top for a 55-gallon tank cost now?
Well, it's all custom-made, different thicknesses. It can go to the moon.
Right. I mean, I've seen them as high as $30, $35.
Oh, north of that.
Right. And so then the other thing I like to do is you can buy the little, what do you call them, little lift on top of the glass.
Well, they're handles for the lid.
Yeah, little handles.
So you can get handles, and you can get them online for, you know, a couple bucks. They're just stick-on aquarium lid handles. But even further than that, we'll have a link for this, is you can go either to your hardware store or Amazon, and you'll see those stick-on-the-wall 3M hooks. They're like little circles with just a little hook, so you can put, like, say, a fishnet on the wall if you want. Well, you can use that as a handle. They're a couple cents a piece, and they work just as well as the, you know, specially made branded aquarium handles.
Right. So whatever you want. To save some bucks, but there's the way to have, you definitely want to put a handle on it, and so you can open that up and feed your fish. Let me see, what else do I got? The other thing I like to do is for aquarium decorations, I like to buy bulk driftwood, and bulk driftwood is not cheap, but it's still cheaper than buying one piece at a time at your local pet store. But the problem everybody has with the driftwood is that it always wants to float to the top. And what I like to do is just get a huge piece of slate, and most of the pet stores will sell all these odd-shaped pieces of slate, and I like to get the, you know, one that's as big as my driftwood, and slate is very, very, very soft. And if you take a regular drill bit, you can drill through the bottom of the slate, and then get yourself a small stainless steel screw, and you can screw through the slate very carefully through that hole that you've already drilled and drill into the bottom of that driftwood, and then bury that slate in the gravel, and your driftwood will stay put right where you want it.
And this is not just for the sake of trying to weight it down, although it does do that. It's also for if you have large fish that knock your wood over. You'll have it all set the way you like it, and then something will just tip it over, and you have to continually make it. Plecos, some of the plecos I have, love to dig, and they'll just literally push my wood across the tank.
Right, so that just holds it tight. Another quick money-saving deal is when you have multiple tanks, I like to buy the 4-foot LED 5,000 lumen lights that you can get at your local big box stores. I pick mine up from a place called Harbor Freight, and I'm getting them for $20 a piece, and that will, a couple of those will light up your entire 8-foot rack.
So these are normally sold as utility lights. So just certainly check what you're purchasing, and you know, be conscious that these aren't waterproof. So if they drop in the tank, you might have a problem.
Right. So I just hang mine up, especially when I make my own stands, you can just screw them up there nice and tight, and they don't go anywhere. And then I like to put like 6 of them on a power strip, and so all I have to do is push the power strip and all my lights go off on my whole rack.
And then you can put that to an Alexa adapter just to say, turn on my aquarium lights. Mm-hmm.
Really?
I mean,
you're that damn lazy.
I don't want to touch things, especially after you have a cold and whatnot.
Exactly. The other thing that I like to buy, I buy everything in bulk. I buy all my fish bags in bulk, because if you have a bunch of tanks, your friends come over, they want to fish. If you go to the pet store to trade in some fish, or you're breeding fish for somebody, you need bulk fish bags. Everything I buy is in bulk. I buy my fish food in 5-pound increments. And there's also a lot of places, like our friend Steve Rubicki, he sells all kinds of crazy different flakes, and he'll sell them to you in 1-pound bags. So he's got 1-pound spirulina flake. He's got 1-pound earthworm flake. Where do you find earthworm flake? Where do you find blackworm flake? Where do you find egg yolk flake? I mean, he's got all that stuff. And there's other places out there, too. And if you have multiple tanks or if you have friends, I mean, you're paying $8 for a pound versus paying $8 for a small little 3-ounce container. You need to save money. Go out and buy the stuff in bulk. Share it with a friend. Put it in the freezer.
So it's not just even buying in bulk for a cheaper price, but it also, like you said, you can get all different types. You literally make your own mix. So it's not just this just general generic tropical fish food. You're getting a little bit of garlic that, you know, Adam's been preaching. You get a little bit of, bloodworm to add in, which normally never come in flake.
All kinds of crazy stuff that you can just save a lot of money on. And when you've got these different fish, we had some fish that would not breed for us. And then I talked to Steve Rubicki. He said, you know, try this particular flake, and I did, and by God, it did trigger them to spawn. They weren't getting enough spirulina in their diet, so I mixed that a little bit heavier, and spirulina does a lot of wonderful things.
Well, I mean, you're never in the mood when you go to McDonald's. You gotta be wined and dined.
Wined and dined. So the other thing I like to do, my local pet store that I sell a lot of shrimp to, they sell me gravel for my tanks. I know Rob doesn't like gravel. He's a big sand man.
It sucks.
Oh.
I don't want to vacuum my stuff. I just want to look pretty.
Adam, gravel? Adam like gravel?
Gravel is way better than sand.
See,
sand,
yeah, sucks. 2-1. But anyway, gravel in a 50-pound bag is probably about $14. And where else can you get anything that cheap? And it's a natural-colored gravel.
See, we need Mr. Pickles in here to back me up on this. He likes sand, too.
Mr. Pickles is in Canada freezing his butt off.
Yeah, he can. Canadians don't count. This is American.
Hey, Mr. American. Pickles is sorry, and he wanted me to tell you that.
Yeah. The other thing, I like to go to my big box store, like the Menards or Home Depot. I get these spring clamps because when I do a lot of water changes, I get these 99-cent spring clamps, and they're just a heavy clamp that you can clamp your hose down to and avoid spilling all over the place.
It works great for hoses, any type of attachments, and you can hang your fish nets on them when you're not using them. But when you have some extras, you can also use them later to Mel Gibson yourself.
No, nobody wants that. Nobody wants to hear that. God, you need to quit
didgeridoo,
drinking.
Jim.
Didgeridoo. Yeah, didgeridoo.
Oh, no.
I'm going to start drinking NyQuil now.
Full freedom!
Yeah. The other thing for saving some money, I like to buy plant bulbs. Adam doesn't like plant bulbs.
No.
Me and Rob's, we like plant bulbs.
Adam, we need to talk. You're not, you want to be a hippie, but you're not full hippie. You got to grow your own plants if you want to go all the way.
Right. I've had really bad luck with them because maybe it was the salt coating on them. I heard that they had a lot of nitrates added to them, and I was always trying to keep the brown algae out of my tanks because of the plecos and stuff that I had, because the diatoms just kill plecos. See, the diatom algae does.
But
so that's why I never had them.
But you got to make the compromise. You need to earn that ponytail.
That's right. So recently Jen and I just bought some Madagascar lace bulbs. Madagascar? Is that what it's called?
Madagascar, yeah.
He knows fish, not geography.
Yeah, I don't know where I'm at. I'm in the basement with Rob's.
With string, a lot of string.
No.
And a didgeridoo.
No. Yeah, I guess we do have a didgeridoo. But anyway, the bulbs are about $1.50 to $3 a piece. And you throw them in the tank. I just throw them in a bare bottom tank until they sprout. And once they sprout, then I'll put them in the gravel. But if you're out to buy a Madagascar lace plant, it's going to cost you $12 to $15.
That's wholesale prices. I've seen them as crazy as $35.
Yeah, right.
And that's just a sprout. It's crap, you know.
And then there's also like the Apon Wonder bulbs that we can get for, you know, under $1. And I'll throw in 50, and I'll get 45 of them to pop up. And those things, once they've been in your tank for 2 weeks, they take off, and they'll grow 3 to 4 inches in a week.
And it's going to be pretty hard for us to find links for those products for you because they vary all over the place. I recommend trying to go to Wish.com for a lot of these plant seeds because you can get them. I don't know if you've used Wish before. Wish is crazy. They'll just give you an item for free just to pay shipping. Of course, they're making their money in their shipping, but check them out. They also have loose ones for, you know, dwarf hair grass for the bottom of your tank. Lots of ways to get bulbs and seeds.
Right. And, you know, you can buy 25 of them. And even if you only get 18 of them up, you're still money ahead. The other thing I'd like to use, too, is I don't like multiple those glass thermometers, those digital thermometers. I mean, you're talking $3 for a glass thermometer for your tank. You're talking those digital thermometers are $3-4 per tank. And what I like to do is I bought a laser temp gun, and I can go by every tank and just zap them. And I do have some tanks with heaters in them, so I do want to check those. And when we hit heavy cold here in Minnesota, the temperature in my basement drops, but I still can check every tank with just a pole on my laser temp gun. And you can pick those up for like $25.
And it's also great to use that same laser temp gun when you go to your local buffet. You just sit there, you point at the food, you scan it, and then they'll just go make fresh food. They won't They're like, who are you? You must be a health inspector. And then they'll just make everything new.
I like to walk in with a clipboard and a tie on, and usually I eat for free. And that's the way to go.
That's because you look like a bouncer.
Yeah, exactly. And for those people that love cichlids out there, and you know, you can go to the pet store, you can go to your local garden center and buy these large stones. What I'd like to do is I'd like to drive by Target, and they have all these large stones out in their parking lot, you know, what they landscape with, and I just like to load up. You know, just take a bucket and just load up, and if they look at you, just say, I'm cleaning out cigarette butts or something, you know?
So, hold on.
What?
Hold on. We gotta warn our listeners here, because next we're going to have a video of people stealing, ransacking Targets across it, and Targets have cameras. So, if you're going to do this... Don't do this, number one.
Don't do this.
Don't do this. But if you're going to do this, right, if you're going to do this, make sure it's some, you know, low-key place without cameras. Do your homework. You know, if you're shopping there, look up. Do you see something on a light pole? You know,
so probably not the bank either.
Go to your local dentist office. They're not going to have cameras out front.
Why are you giving them tips?
They're not doing this. We've established we're telling them not to. But if they're going to, the dentist has enough money, trust me.
It's kind of like, you know, there's that tag on your blow dryer saying, don't use this in the shower. And people do.
Caution, coffee's hot, but yet I drink it.
Yes, exactly.
I mean, come on now.
What? So, that was a loud sigh from
the
Adam.
Official statement from the Aquarium Guys podcast is that it's illegal. Do not steal from people.
But if you're going to, I mean,
take a didgeridoo because no one will believe that you're stealing rocks.
That's right. And rocks... And you know what? It's not like they got those serial rocks. Don't have serial numbers, okay? So if you're driving away from somewhere with a big bucket of rocks, I mean, prove it.
Well, don't do a big bucket. Just fill your pockets.
Oh, there we go. Yeah. Oh, what else?
Don't do that. Don't steal rocks.
Don't.
Yes. Don't steal rocks.
Don't steal rocks.
And don't give your fish Nordic funerals.
don't.
No, that's actually a good thing. Give him the funeral.
Jesus. Oh, my Lord. The last thing I got is, let's talk about pickle jars for 15 minutes. I love pickle jars. I use them for a lot of things. Go out and buy yourself 4-gallon pickle jars. They're about $14 for 4 jars.
Now, I have to stop you there.
Why?
It has to be glass jars. Do not do gallon ranch containers because they don't hold fish as well. Although I have gallon ranch containers.
I know you do. Every time we go to a restaurant with Rob's, he orders ranch, and he looks him straight in the eye, and he goes, lots and lots of ranch. And she goes,
No, I don't. I'm not that childish.
Yes, you do.
I say copious amounts.
Copious amounts, exactly, which means lots and lots. But anyway, I found that if I went over to my local recycling center, and I told the guy, I said, I'm looking for some glass jars. They said, how many do you want? I said, you know, why don't you grab me like a dozen? And they called me back like about 4 days later and said, I got like 60 of them. And I said, thanks a lot. And I went over there. I picked up a pizza at Pizza Hut for $6.99. I dropped it off. They were excited. I went home with 60 jars. I was excited. And I love jars.
So what do you do with the jars?
I use the jars for hatching angelfish eggs.
Oh, I thought it's your rock collections.
No, I keep my rock collections in the back of my car. And I also hatch brine shrimp in my gallon jars. And I collect leaves, like oak leaves, and put in my jar. What are we talking about this for? I've only got 15 minutes to talk about jars. What else we got? Oh, Amquil. I like Amquil. Do you like Amquil, Robs?
I'm not going to lie. I didn't even know what it was until you brought it on the list. I'm like, all right, cool.
So Rob is such a fish nerd, and he's a tech nerd. He's like nerd squared. He didn't know what Amquil is.
Nope.
And I love Amquil.
Everybody knew what it was.
I know. Me and Adam are like, what are you dumb or what?
I just feel like it's some sort of like Tylenol PM, but drug related somehow.
Yeah, and that's why you sleep upside down in the closet.
NyQuil, Amquil, it's close.
So Amquil, help me out here, Adam. It gets rid of ammonia and chloramines?
Chlorine. Yeah, chloramines in your water.
So
and
do you use this to like rub on the sides of a pool and conversion of it, you know, get the chlorine off the walls?
No, you put this in the fish tank.
Fish tank, dum-dum.
Well, then why do you buy it by the gallon?
I buy it by the gallon because I import fish, and I'll get in. Seriously, they send 300 neons in a bag of, you know, in one large bag. And when you open up that bag, you can smell the ammonia.
So you crack the bag open and you just put a little in there.
Put a little splash in there.
Splash it up.
And it kills the ammonia right away.
So what splash? Are we talking like I'm going to splash up a little cologne for my night out of town? Or
I'm talking like 4 or 5 drops. It's not a lot. I mean, it goes
about that. Then.
It goes a long ways. But for when you're doing massive amounts of water changes, it, you know, a couple drops and you're good to go. And it works wonderful. And it's pretty inexpensive. And they sell it by
30 by the gallon.
By the gallon. I buy it by the gallon. But
they do have smaller containers, and we'll have the link for you.
I think that's about all I got for you, Robs.
That's it?
I've got more, but I'm saving it for the big podcast.
The Fish Room podcast.
The Fish Room podcast. I can't relieve, you know, all my secrets.
Okay. Also, one last tip.
What's
right,
that?
For the listeners. So if you're having trouble and you've been working with maybe one of your favorite fish and it's just not getting better, it's on its last leg, you know, maybe it was a birth defect and it's just finally now croaking. Maybe you see it has a tumor, hole in the head, and you just can't beat the disease. And it's time that you want to euthanize your fish. And it's a struggle, you know. Just get out your didgeridoo and blow in front of it until it craps.
What?
And dies. Please.
You have no love for the didgeridoo. Yeah. I'm going to.
And then your flower horn's finally out. You just put him out of his misery in a very, I don't know, soothing manner.
It's kind of like.
It's like how he wanted to go. He wanted a middle-aged, you know, attractive. Oh.
I'm not very
that
good
was pathetic.
I'm not very good at this.
I swear, it sounds like you're taking a PVC pipe and you're trying to fart through it.
I have to
and
practice
when it
more.
Dies, you have to go to the Viking funeral.
All right, please, please, listeners, I'm begging you. Make him stop. Oh, there, now he got something that sounds. Wait, he doesn't know geography. He doesn't know this comes from Australia.
Yeah.
Please. Call in, let Jimmy know he should never play the didgeridoo on the podcast again.
Next week, I'm going to sing. I'm going to do that song, Rock the Cat Box. Oh, no, it's Rock the Casbah. Never mind. My wife calls it Rock the Cat Box because she's illiterate. I don't know.
I'm so confused. Let's wrap this up, guys. So please share this with your friends.
Don't share it with
Tell your friends to call into the podcast and tell Jim to stop playing the didgeridoo. AquariumGuys.com. If you like us, you know, share with your friends, subscribe on your favorite podcast platform. We just added a couple others that I didn't know existed, Castbox, others. Give us a subscription and, you know, join us on Twitter, Facebook. You know, I'd love to hear your guys' tips and tricks and hacks that don't involve the didgeridoo on our Facebook account to share with everyone. Again, last check, I think we're over 110 people, and that's just in a few hours joining the group. Hop on and join us in Discord. That's how you can get us live. You can talk to us on there. We actually have our guests shoot the podcast on Discord with us, so we can do this remotely at high fidelity. And we love you.
And the thing is, too, if you don't like this podcast, we have a guarantee on this podcast. We are going to double your money back.
Yeah, it costs you nothing.
Two times nothing?
We'll give you nothing.
Nothing back.
No, we're going to give them our love and affection and then never play the didgeridoo.
What?
Yeah, that's ear rape.
Didgeridoo.
That's ear rape.
You know what? I'm thinking about getting a trumpet.
Adam.
I don't have to deal with it.
Adam.
You do.
The didgeridoo makes me want to purchase feeder guppies.
Oh, feeder guppies.
Well, you need more antlers?
And that's our podcast this evening. Thanks again.
Antlers out.
Let's kick that outro.
Epstein didn't kill himself.
Oh, that's not the outro. Which one's? Oh, here it is. Outro.
Thanks, guys, for listening to this podcast. Please visit us at aquariumguyspodcast.com and listen to us on Spotify, iHeartRadio, iTunes, and anywhere you can listen to podcasts.
We're practically everywhere. We're on Google. I mean, just go to your favorite place, Pocket Casts, subscribe, make sure it gets push notifications directly to your phone. Otherwise, Jim will be crying in his sleep.
Can I listen to it in my treehouse?
In your treehouse, in your fish room, even alone at work.
What about at my man cave?
Especially your man cave.
Yeah.
Only if Adam's there.
No.
With feeder guppies.
No.
They're endless.
You midget-loving, sucking motherfucker.
Well, I guess we'll see you next time. Later.